Welcome. Thank you very much for joining us today for this series of ISC interviews with people around the world who are thinking innovatively about education and the future of education, whether that's in the classroom or in the workplace. Today, we are honored to having as a guest Professor Nick Van Dam, Professor at Nyenrode University and Global Chief Learning Officer at Kinsey & Company. He has spent much of his career ensuring that individuals develop to their fullest potential within organizations. Personally, I like very much the way he summarizes his view on education when he writes that learning is the new knowing. Good morning, Nick. Thanks for being with us. Before we start this conversation, I remind you that time permitting, we will take questions. To ask a question, please click on Ask a Question below the video screen. We'll try to answer questions at the end of the conversation. Nick, you've written a lot on this advent of the fourth industrial revolution, which you've said is the advent of this cyber-physical system. How does it affect workplace learning?
Yeah. Well, first, thank you for inviting me for this presentation, for the interview today. Yes, I think we are at a very exciting time in history. At the beginning of what the World Economic Forum has called the fourth industrial revolution. It's basically a revolution that is fueled by new technologies, you know, including robotization, the Internet of Things, cloud computing, machine learning, the mobile internet, 3D printing, and so on. And if you look at a lot of research reports on all the new technologies, it's very obvious that over the next 15 years, there will be significant changes in work that people are doing in organizations. All these technologies will drive the need for very different skills, very different jobs in organizations. And if you couple that with a lifespan of people that has extended over the years, and if I just reflect on a book written by Linda Gretton, a professor at LBS, she talks about the 100-year life. And basically, if you think about if people are getting older, they will be in the workforce for 40 to 50 years. Now, back to the Industrial Revolution. If you look at, you know, people are in the workforce for a long time, and there is so many changes in technology that has an impact on work. It means basically that people have to continue develop new skills and get ready for very new jobs in their careers. And that's what I call people have to become serial masters. Basically, you might learn a profession in your early 20s, but then in your 30s or 40s, you know, you will become deep in a new discipline. So you need to continue learn and grow and become lifelong learners. And that's the only way for people to continue to be successful in their careers.
Thank you, Nick. But then in this context, what is that makes a world-class learning organization, an organization that will be challenging, that will be ready for this challenge of that are just there?
Yeah, I truly believe that organizations who truly embrace learning and embrace a learning culture are basically organizations who have turned the workplace into a learning place. And what I mean with that is that basically organizations have shaped an environment, a physical environment, but also an overall culture where basically people do something differently, do something new every day. And as a consequence of that, they will learn every day. Because what we know about learning is that people only learn if they work on new things. So basically, you get out of your comfort zone and you go into your learning zone. And that's kind of what you need to have. So organizations who make that happen, a workplace really... That cannot be automated. It cannot be taken over by robots or machines. And that's where humans continue to play an incredible important role. Think about things that can happen in organizations in the future. And it's all about ideation. It's all about creativity. Now, you mentioned also collaboration as an example. And developing collaborative skills is also incredibly important. Some of the research that McKinsey has presented shows that activities where people collaborate with other people, activities that people are leading, is a task, is a competence that also cannot be automated. And that's kind of where humans come in. And to develop more human skills, of course, it's a little bit nature and nurture. There are people by nature who are really good, actually. But to a very large extent, this can be developed. It can be developed by making sure that, let's say, students, executive leaders are pulled together in different teams, learn how to collaborate, learn how to work together. So that's also another example. And in terms of problem solving, critical thinking, also very important moving forward. And that's also what you learn by basically get exposed to pretty complex problems and apply different methodologies in terms of problem solving, how to figure out how to solve a complex problem. Now, the last thing what I want to say about this is that this goes back to authentic leadership. We live in a time where basically there's tremendous change, a lot of complexity, but also a lot of uncertainty. We don't have all the data at our fingertips to make necessarily every single decision. And that means that also intuition will play a big role. And also learning from other people, learn from different teams about how they think about solving a specific problem. So I believe that authentic leaders in the 21st century are basically leaders who are very inclusive in their leadership. They make sure that everybody on the team is involved in the problem solving. And together, you basically bet on, you know, on a couple of scenarios and say, okay, based on all the data, everything what we know, based on our own intuition, based on our own wisdom, what are the right things to do here? And I think that goes back to the right leader, authentic leader, who is very inclusive, who collaborates with other people, who has an open mindset, has a mindset ideation. And I think that's a recipe for success in organizations.
Well, thank you, Nick. Very insightful, very inspiring. You've mentioned what humans, these human capacities, capabilities that cannot be automatized. So that what distinguish at the end would distinguish humans from robots, from machines. Well, that's somehow going to very deep topics. That at the end is what's in human nature, what makes us human. That's going to these topics that can be at the end more philosophical and that require reflection. But at the same time, it seems that with this, with this advent of technology, speed needs to be always there, and the attention span is getting more reduced. So people seem not to be so inclined to spend time on reflection, on just be there to stop and think. And at the same time, people, and especially we see that in our schools, especially young MBA students or young this aspiring leaders. So what they are looking in education is for the what has an immediate practical return. They don't seem to be so interested in this type of topics that you mentioned. How can we, what's the view on how can we get people, more employees, more interested in acquiring these skills?
Yeah. Thank you for the question. I think it's a lot about mindsets. And I think it's like we need to help our people in organizations to develop a mindset that basically they need to continue learn and grow over the years. And that basically this will require an ongoing investment, actually. And if I compare this as an example with, let's say, a healthy life, we all know that if we just eat one day very healthy, that's not a guarantee for longer term. Basically, we need to change our habits. We need to eat healthy every day in order to stay healthy over time. It's the same with work, actually. There's never been a time that people have been exposed to more information than today. There also has not been a time that people have been such incredibly busy as today. And in my interaction with a lot of leaders from organizations, they acknowledge that basically, and they tell me, Nick, we are busy from 8 to late. And during our work, we have hardly time to reflect. And that's what they express as a big gap. And therefore, I believe that it's incredibly important that we help leaders to step away from their day-to-day work, be in a different place, and spend time with them to reflect on themselves, because I believe that leading organizations, leading teams, start always with leading yourself. So being a centric leader means you need to be aware of yourself, you need to take time for reflection, you need to develop this mindset that this is incredibly important, because if you want to think longer term, what makes sense, you know, the next 2, 3, 5 years, it's critical to do so. And so taking people away, give them time for reflection, is incredibly valued. And I believe if we look ahead the next 5 to 10 years, the need for reflection will just increase. In a time that people are 24/7 almost on the internet, on the mobile phone, etc., this will become so important for people to be sustainable, successful in their organizations. So a big place in leadership development, you know, the need to find time for reflection, to stand, to stop actually, ask questions, reflect on it, and think about the future.
Yeah. Thank you, Nick. So time for reflection, time to unplug, time to recover energy. And you've mentioned healthy diet. I know that you are a strong advocate, for instance, of the importance and the relevance of sleep. I remember a paper that you published a year ago, and then the organizational cost of insufficient sleep. So do you think that these topics like sleep, physical exercise, healthy diet, mindfulness practices, etc., should be part of this learning practices, both in companies and organizations, and also in schools, in business schools like your school or ISE?
Yeah, I think this is an incredibly important area of focus for people. And as I mentioned, in a lifespan, people will work 40 to 50 years in incredible busy jobs. It's it's very important to stay healthy. And our research on sleep suggests that if people, as an example, don't sleep enough, it has a huge impact on their learning capability. So it's hard to memorize things, as an example. It's hard. It has a huge impact on their ability to solve problems and to be creative. And third, and very important, it also has a huge impact on relationship building. People who don't sleep enough have a huge challenge in terms of being more empathic, being more human because of the consequence of less sleep. So this is a huge correlation in terms of being an effective leader and a successful leader and having enough sleep. Now, for a lot of people, this is kind of, they've never thought about this. Even are people who are kind of bragging to say, well, I only need 5 hours of sleep, or I can only sleep 4 hours. If you look at all the research data, you really talk about a few outliers. Most of us need enough sleep in order to function well. And also, lack of sleep has a huge potential negative impact on your health over time. Now, other topics you mentioned, nutrition is an example, exercise, same thing, has a huge impact on staying healthy in the organization. So from a McKinsey perspective, you know, we are including these topics in our leadership programs, in our programs for our consultants, and also more and more of our clients are basically expecting the same thing, because they see the big correlation between, you know, a healthy life and actually being successful at work.
Oh, thank you. Glad to know that these practices that you mean in your work and in consulting, and the clients are accepting more and more these practices, and they understand the relevance of those topics. Yeah, it's another question, Nick. So we are thinking of how to develop, let's say, or tools that individually we can develop as leaders. But if the focus is on this individual personal development, there is maybe the risk that the sense of common culture and organizational culture may suffer?
Yeah, I think it's a good question too. And I think if we think about developing people and developing teams, developing organizations, all these development dimensions need to be addressed. So I think if we bring people together from one organization in a leadership development program, it's not just about the individual development. It's also a development of an overall team. There's also discussion about the organization, about the culture of the organization. So I think it's a combination of both. We need to address the individual development, and we need to make sure that what we do from a development perspective is also tied to the overall business strategy of an organization. And as part of that, it's also the culture of the organization that needs to be addressed in leadership development programs. So it's both. We need to do both.
Thank you. I see on the screen that we have some question. So I see that they may convey to you. So I see someone asking, actually, hello, Florencia, thanks for sending the question. You say, how you deal with cognitive load management in the fourth industrial revolution?
Sorry, the first one, third part, I missed, actually.
So the question
is,
how do you deal with this, with the cognitive load management? In the fourth industrial revolution?
Yeah. So basically people get exposed to a lot of information, a lot of knowledge. And to me, what is important is that this also goes back to learning and how we learn, that we need to make a difference between what I call look up knowledge. So knowledge that we can find on our smartphones, on the internet, etc. Knowledge that we don't need to retain. And then there's also what I call must know knowledge. So knowledge that we need to retain, actually. So although there's a significant overload of information, I think as individuals and as leaders, we need to be conscious in terms of what is the information we need to remember and what is information we just need to find, actually. And by making that distinction, actually, we can deal with a cognitive information overload.
Oh, thank you. I see another question. They say, if skill sets are changing more quickly than ever, how can you prepare workers for tomorrow? Again, a question related to speed.
I think there are a couple of things to consider, actually, for people. Let's say if you are in a specific role in a specific industry, you need to ask yourself the question, what is the outlook for me of retaining in my role over the next 5 years? So if you are in a job where it's likely that big parts can be automated, so first become aware of that. So for yourself to do the assessment on that question, actually. So what will happen potentially with my job? And then if you say, well, there's a high chance that it will be automated or robotized, then you need to reflect on, okay, what are jobs for the future? What are new jobs that you can, you might be interested in? And how can you get ready for that? And it could be, you go back to, you take an education, a study, you start with a new study, let's say part-time next to your job, to start preparing yourself for a new role in an organization. So let me give you an example. 10 years ago, it's 10 years ago that the iPhone was launched. A decade ago, the job app developer did not exist. Today, there are more than 13, 14 million people who are app developers. So new technology creates also a lot of new jobs, actually. So it's important for individuals to be conscious about what their job is today and reflect on what their job could look like now and think about how you can prepare yourself for a new or extended job.
Well, I think we still have time for one final question. So among these skills or abilities that you've mentioned before that are essential for this fourth industrial revolution, you've mentioned creativity, collaboration, critical thinking. Maybe a link to the critical thinking, I think it's very important, moral judgment. That's something that's at the core of what distinguishes us from machines, from robots. No? How do we develop this moral lens, this ethical sense, this moral judgment?
Yeah, I think it goes back to getting people exposed to cases, questions, problems, which require a moral or ethical perspectives and judgment. So having basically with students a discussion on specific themes, actually, which require that. And it's only by practicing that basically people develop those very specific and important skills. There is so much that we can learn still from the philosophers that still applies today. And I think that's something that we sometimes forget. There are many problems that we deal with that basically, people have been dealing with long, long time ago. So going back in time, back to history, back to the old philosophers, we can learn tremendously from them and apply their thinking on existing problems in organizations can be extremely insightful and powerful.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you. Maybe that's a good point for the end of this conversation, connecting the new with the very old, with the classical wisdom. That's right. Okay. Thanks for your time, and especially thanks for sharing with us all these insightful thoughts and the product of your study and research. And thank you, everybody. Thank you very much for listening. And hope we can join us for the next interview. Thank you.